Hey guys, Cody Adair here. I have Jason Merkle and I have Matt Andren from Product Development here today on the show to discuss some of our latest releases, as well as interact with you guys. And just generally, if you guys have some questions for us, we're here to hang out and let you guys know what's going on with Horizon.
Yeah, so hey guys, Cody is going to take a few minutes here to share this live stream out to some of our other Facebook pages. So in case you're seeing this later on YouTube in particular, don't be alarmed if you don't see him paying attention to myself and Matt or to some of the comments on the screen at the moment while he does that. And then later on in the broadcast here, he's going to be addressing some people's comments. So he'll respond to you the best that he can in the live chat, both on Facebook at the moment and then also on YouTube. And real quick, just to tell you guys, the goal here is to actually have this hangout every week, same time, Friday afternoon at 4 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Central, and then 1 p.m. Pacific. We want to each week bring on a special guest. This week, Mr. Matt Andren is joining us. And next week, we'll have another guest and so on and so forth. We will also discuss, if we had that prior Thursday, for those that don't know, we typically release new products on Thursdays. This week, we did not have a new announcement, so please don't be alarmed. There isn't a particularly new announcement today. There will be down the road. But at the moment, we're going to discuss some of the recent announcements and releases, one of which just started shipping yesterday. So we'll get to that here in a minute. And then on top of that, also wanted to mention that you guys will also, again, see these broadcasts, not only on Facebook, but also on YouTube later on. And then we'll try our best to comment even after this live session is over. If you leave your questions, leave your comments in those comments sections, we'll try to address them as quickly as we can. But be sure to tune in each week because we're pretty excited that this is a great opportunity for us to interact with you guys, hang out with you guys, bring on a special guest, and then also talk about some really cool things that we're doing, especially with products in particular. So without any further ado, I'm going to introduce Mr. Matt Andren. Hey, Matt, how are you?
Doing real good.
Good. So some guys that are already here watching right now may know who Matt is. And for those that don't, I'll just give a really quick summary so you know kind of where he's coming from. Matt is a product developer at Horizon Hobby, and he's the man responsible for the original timber design. And so I know a lot of guys own a timber, love timbers, UMX timbers, big timbers, and everything in between. And Matt was kind of the brainchild behind that for a number of reasons, which I hope he goes into because he has a very special place in his heart for Stoll Aircraft in particular. And I think it's really cool to hear his background in the hobby, how he came to work at Horizon Hobby, and then ultimately what kind of translated into the UMX timber, the timber 1.5, turbo timber, timber X, so on and so forth. And then also, as of yesterday, we just started shipping the all new UMX Citation Longitude, which Matt also worked on. And if I'm not mistaken, I think Matt really likes civilian scale airliners and private jets in particular. So I'm going to let him take it. Go ahead,
yeah.
Matt.
The timber was a really fun project for me. You know, it was one of those projects that's a little bit different than a lot of other ones. You know, if you're doing a scale airplane, you have kind of like a starting point. You know, you're trying to make it look like a type of airplane that's really out there in real life. You know, when you kind of have a blank slate to create your own airplane design, you know, tweak it the way you want it to for the purpose that you're designing it for. In this case, you know, stall flying, short takeoff and landing, you know, really rugged surfaces you could take off and land on. You know, I could do things that aren't on, you know, full size aircraft, or, you know, just tweak the airframe so it flies really good as an RC model. You know, incorporate my own shapes and just my own kind of personality into that design of the airplane of what I would expect a backcountry bush airplane to be. So that was a really fun project to do, and to have, you know, kind of one of your own designs out there and people love flying it. And, you know, it created a lot of different, you know, avenues off that from, you know, the Timber X and the Turbo and the Ultra Micro and everything. So it was really good to see everybody really, you know, gravitate to that subject and just have a lot of fun with it.
Yeah, I think a lot of guys have either bought and own multiple or at least one timber and or have flown a timber at one point or another. And for sure, I think almost everybody's seen one fly at this point. And so what I like about it is that it you know, to the uneducated eye, really, they look like real aircraft. You know, we've got a typical cabin, we've got, you know, a relatively typical plan form. But like Matt said, guys, he was able to, because we didn't have the scale constraints, to kind of cheat the design of the airplane to optimize its flight performance for stall and good handling and all those things all around. So can you speak a little bit more to some of the design elements that you tweaked over what you would have done on a scale airplane to make it fly better?
Absolutely. So, you know, one of the things that I think made it just a really great platform is I was able to stretch the moments of the airplane a little bit. I was able to make the tail a little bit longer than, say, a traditional J3 Cub. If you overlay the 3 view of a J3 Cub over a Timber, you'll see that the fuselage of a J3 is much shorter. Also, the tail surfaces are considerably smaller. You know, I wanted the authority at low airspeeds, and especially on RC models that just don't behave the way a full-size airplane is. You can't just take a full-size airplane, shrink it down to that size, and not tweak things on it to make it fly well as a model. So to do some of those things, you know, just we actually made the wing a little bit bigger after we started with the first couple of samples because we wanted that wing loading to get even lighter. You know, having the ability to put the slats on or off was an interesting, you know, addition that you could actually see make a difference when you put them on. Yeah, it limited some automatic air capabilities, but, you know, our thinking was, well, this thing's designed for short takeoff and landing. Let's make it the best at that. And the guys who want a little bit more aerobatic capability, they don't have to put the slats on. If you want crazy aerobatic capability, well, we had to come out with the Timber X for that one. So
yeah. Well, I think a lot of guys to this day still ask, do I want to install the slats or should I leave them off? And I think that you get mixed comments on the forums, but from your experience, what does installing the slats take away from the plane without the slats installed? And then what does it also add?
So basically, the thing that it probably removes the most is it does reduce the roll rate slightly. You know, you're basically turning a fairly high lift wing into a very high lift wing, and trying to get it to roll through the air with that change on the wing just makes it roll a little bit slower. I mean, it's not excessive, but you can feel it on versus off. The biggest change is inverted performance, and that's where you really see it because, again, leading edge slats are designed for upright performance. Inverted, they start doing some really weird things to the air, and you lose some of that elevator authority for a negative push or to do like an outside loop.
Right.
What it gains for you is it makes the air more active over the top of the wing, makes the ailerons more active at slow speed, especially when you're hanging out to dry, coming in, trying to do that stall landing. You don't lose that aileron effect when the wing starts getting real close to a stall, and it allows you to fly at a slightly higher angle of attack before the airplane does stall. And you can see that when you're flying it. You can hang it out a little bit more with the slats on and you know, use the throttle to keep that nose up and actually do, you know, tail wheel first landings and stuff like that.
Right. I see Robert Moore on Facebook just commented, the slats are also affect inverted flight. Don't try an outside loop with them installed. He's pretty right. Pretty right on that. So I think that's a great kind of overall explanation of what slats give and what they kind of take away. So it is not for everyone. And I really think it's kind of personally dependent. What are you looking for? Stall performance, high lift, draggy, upright performance? Are you looking for, you know, pretty good upright performance, but a little bit better inverted performance and roll rate and so on and so forth. And so personally, I don't fly with the slats installed on any of my Timber models. I keep the slats off, but I have flown with them and I have seen the difference in performance myself. And again, that's why I choose to have them off because I like to fly inverted. I like to do aerobatic flying. But at the same time, most other people that I've seen fly Timbers, their goal is to take off and land as short as possible and fly around as slow as possible. So it makes a lot of sense for them to install the slats. So real quick, Matt.
Exactly.
Talk a little bit about your history in the hobby. When did you start? How did you start? And then how the heck did you end up at Horizon designing airplanes like the Timber?
Well, I actually first started flying RC in 1993. I was given a gentlelady sailplane kit for Christmas. And was really excited. You know, the box looked really cool. Had an awesome picture of a sailplane on it. Open it up, and it's a box of sticks. You're like, this doesn't look anything like the picture. And realized it was actually going to be some work to get it in the air. I've always had a passion for aviation. Basically, planes, trains, cars, trucks. You know, since I was a little kid, I've always been into that stuff. And for some reason, I've always gravitated towards aviation. I started flying in 1993, like I said, over spring break, and had the help of a lot of really, really great guys in the soaring community in New Mexico. And there's some killer thermals out there. So, you know, RC soaring was a pretty big thing when I got into it. I did that for a number of years before I ever flew anything with an engine. I started designing some of my own airplanes just based off of the gliders I had. You know, I'd have the plans there. I'd trace the airfoil and kind of make something that looked like what I had, but maybe a little different, and just kept refining that and learning what kind of works and what didn't. You know, I flew for many, many years, finally flew some engine on it, was hooked on that, finally flew something electric. I thought that was amazing back in the elevation I was at. I worked at a general aviation airport, you know, for a number of years. So I was, you know, around aviation pretty much my whole life, in some way, shape or form. I worked at a couple hobby stores in New Mexico. Actually one of the daughters of the hobby store owner is actually Cali Graphics, which many of you are probably familiar with, and does amazing graphics for all our RC products. So definitely check that out. But, it's just been an interesting path to go on that. And when I was working at the full size airport, one of our students said, there's a whole bunch of hobby companies in Illinois. You should check it out. It's interesting. I don't know why they're all there. And I never really gave it much thought. I did have relatives in Southern Illinois, so I would come out to Illinois a couple times a year. And for some reason, I decided, let's check out the companies. And so we drove up to Champaign and went to both Hobbyco and Horizon. I filled out applications, and surprisingly, the next day got a call from Horizon, and basically moved my whole life all the way across the country to join Horizon. And I've been there 26 years. I just celebrated my 20th anniversary on March 30th. So
Wow.
Congrats.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. So real quick, just to let people know, when you started at Horizon, you were not originally a product developer, right?
No, I actually started in consumer sales and did that for a little over a year. There was an opening for a aircraft technician, both on the what would be the zones, park zone, hangar nine, or E-flite and hobby zone, as well as a hangar nine opening. And I happened to get the hangar nine opening and was basically the aircraft technician for hangar nine for a number of years, building samples, reporting on them back to the vendors. A very similar product developer role, but doing a lot of the building of those kind of airplanes, which is a little bit more involved than opening a foamy box and assembling it in 15 minutes. So I did that for a number of years. And then because I've always had a passion for electrics, you know, they're just clean, they work, you can run more scale diameter looking props. You don't have to cut holes in your cowl, you don't have to clean it up afterwards. So when an opportunity opened for me to be a product developer on the electric side, I jumped at the chance and I've been doing it ever since.
Awesome. And you have worked on a lot of airplanes. I think probably the ones that in the most recent memory guys will know well are the Timbers, of course, but then the EC-1500 was your one of your brainchilds?
Yep.
And then
absolutely. The 900.
More recently was the Citation, the UMX Citation, which I see you have behind you. Cody's got one behind him. And that literally just started shipping in the U.S. and in Europe yesterday. And so a lot of guys already have one on the way. Some guys may even have gotten theirs today. But can you talk a little bit about how you arrived at that subject matter? And then also, why did we end up going with 30-millimeter fans and 3S instead of 28-millimeter fans and 2S?
Absolutely. So, you know, we've done a number of Cessna aircraft in the past. So we've had a relationship with them. You know, we have the Carbon Z Cessna 150. We have the Ultramicro Cessna 182. And we've done a number of other Cessna products over the years. So it made it good to go and see what they had. And they had this gorgeous, gorgeous, brand new business that they were just starting to produce. It was just going through certification. It had good lines, good wing area, and looked like it would actually be a nice RC model. So we thought, hey, let's give it a shot. We designed it originally around the UMX A10 power system for 2S 800 power. Mm-hmm. And the sample was actually a little bit, well, considerably bigger than what we actually ended up at. We got the sample and I flew it. And while it flew very well, it was pretty, pretty anemic performance. It took a long time to climb to altitude. And like I said, it flew well. It was just very, very underpowered for what we would expect from a product that we want to deliver. So we went back kind of to the drawing board a little bit and just started shrinking the airframe. And that was probably the biggest challenge. We shrank the airframe down, but you got to shrink it without making it look bad. You know, you don't want to make the wing too small as you get it smaller, because that just makes it handle worse. You don't want the nacelles to start looking too big on an airplane because you can't shrink down the fans you're going to use. As we shrunk it down, went through a couple more samples, we realized we just weren't hitting the performance that we wanted out of this model. It was okay and it was getting better, but it was just kind of work to fly. You know, it took a while to climb to altitude to be able to do aerobatics if you wanted. And like I said, it looked great in the air, but it just wasn't what we wanted to deliver. So we started investigating 3S options and found out that using a, you know, fairly high KV outrunner with a slightly bigger fan with six blades gave us a really, really huge performance increase. I mean, the power this thing has will blow away any other ultra micro EDF that we've ever come out with by far.
Yeah, it's fast. It's fast, but also has incredible vertical. And I guess I would say some people have pointed this out. It has way more performance than the full scale airplane has. It's way more capable than a full scale airplane. And guys, please remember, you don't have to fly it that way. Just because we put more power in it into it, because that's kind of the expectation of you know, the customer base today, based on other more modern day EDFs, you can throttle back, you can fly at scale, you can put it on low rates, you don't have to do loops and rolls and inverted flight. We show those things in our videos because it can do that. And, you know, for someone like myself, I really love having an airplane that looks the part and I can fly it the way it looks, but then I can also do more than what it looks like it can do. And I think a lot of people appreciate that. And so, you know, and that said, one thing that we've noticed is you can fly it probably on 2S if you really wanted to, right?
Yeah.
So some guys have 2S batteries left over from either their A10, UMX A10, or maybe the UMX Aero Commander. Those both use like 2-cell 800 is pretty common in those. And so we do have the auto cell detect LVC built into the ESC that's inside there, or the control unit that's inside of the Citation. So if you wanted to use 2S, you can. We didn't design it that way. We didn't build it that way, at least initially. It can be done, but we strongly recommend 3S. And now one thing that you found on 3S batteries is not all 3S batteries are up to the task in this particular model. So what are some of the things guys can watch out for to make sure that, A, they've got a battery that's doing the right thing, and then, B, what's something they might see if their battery's not working right?
Gotcha. Well, the first thing is, this is a extremely high performance EDF. You know, like I mentioned, this is probably the highest performance ultra micro EDF we've ever produced. So it does require some power, and you need to have basically new good batteries. You know, if you have some old worn out 800s, you know, from a V22 or something that you've had a couple of years, probably want to invest at least in a couple new packs for the Citation, because you're going to want that performance. The worst thing you're going to see with a battery that just isn't quite up to the task is just a voltage surge. It really won't cut off, and we've actually done some testing on this and found that the airplane will loop from level flight even while it's surging. The easiest thing to do is just land, you know, fly around for about 60 seconds, 45 seconds or so, unplug your battery, plug it back in, should be good to go, and you should be able to hit full throttle once that battery warms up just a little bit. We also found colder temperatures affect batteries. As you know, these batteries are pretty small. They can cold soak pretty easy, especially in the winter when it's 30 degrees out, but it's a nice, calm, sunny day, and you want to go fly. You got to make sure your packs are at least basically body temperature before you put it on the airplane. If they were sitting in your car overnight, you're going to notice performance. And that's almost any size battery. It's just the smaller ones can be more susceptible to it. I know for a fact our little 1S150s, man, those things would cold soak super fast. And just holding them in your hand for a minute before you flew, especially like when we used to go to the Horizon Indoor in Toledo, and it was really cold in November, and you'd be trying to warm your batteries to get a flight up. So, you know, you just got to make sure your batteries are basically room temperature. Make sure they're a newer, high-quality 30C cell, and you're going to be good to go.
Yeah, so when you mentioned surging, basically that's the built-in LVC. And that low voltage cutoff is intended to prevent you from over discharging the battery. If it's everything is the right conditions, you know, it's warm enough, your battery's up to snuff, you're going to pull like 85% to 95% of capacity out if you hit LVC on a regular day. If you're hitting that right after you take off, then again, you either need to warm up that battery, or maybe even if that battery's warm and it still hits LVC prematurely, you're going to need to find either a different battery or, you know, maybe look at other things, make sure your connectors are all sound and everything like that. Now, we are using a JST on this model, and I know some guys have said, hey, why are you using a JST? We know we're pushing kind of the limits of the connector in this application. I think it pulls 11, 12 amps of full throttle. And so, yes, we could have installed something like our IC2 or EC2 connectors, but that is definitely different than most people have. So we tried to keep things a little bit easy. And as long as you have a good battery with a good set of 18 gauge wires and a solid JST connector, especially the gold plated ones, but you know, some of the silver ones are fine. I think you guys are going to be fine. So one of the batteries we found works pretty well, and I know we're already getting low on stock of them. We have an Onyx 3-cell 800 milliamp 30C battery that I think we were all surprised. You guys pulled a couple out of stock and were flying them last week, and they performed gangbusters, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. We're doing really well. And, you know, when you have a good performing battery like that, when it's warm out, I mean, that fresh voltage jam you can get, I mean, it's kind of impressive, scary kind of how impressive the vertical of this airplane is. I mean, I remember hand launching, pulling straight vertical and going until it's a spec. I mean, literally straight up. So, I mean, the thrust to weight ratio is right at 1-to-1 with this thing. It's got a lot of power. And like you said, you can fly at scale. You can fly it kind of wild and crazy if you want. But having that extra power, even if you're flying at scale, is great. If you get in a bad situation, you need to get out, you can punch it and go and clear that tree or whatever you need. You know, if you were if you didn't have that power when you needed it, it could hurt the airplane if you did hit something. So, you know, to have that power available if you want it is great. But like you said, you don't need it. This airplane looks amazing cruising around at dusk.
Yes, it does.
Around eye level, you got the strobes flashing. You can see the landing lights. Just cruising around doing figure eights. I mean, doing touch and goes and seeing the lights reflect off the runway. It's a lot of fun just doing that.
I'll tell you what, Matt. When I first saw it fly, the top speed that it hit, man, I thought for sure it was gonna break the sound barrier. Man, that thing must be moving.
Yeah, when like you said, when you got a good battery that's warmed up and it's fully charged, I had the wheels installed and we were doing some takeoffs in the parking lot when we were shooting the flight talk video, and it's amazing. You can just punch it and be off the ground in like 5 feet. And then pull straight up vertical, and then you can even pull through a loop and come back down the runway. It's pretty impressive, the performance. Yeah. To be honest, it's probably better than most of the larger EDFs that are out there. You know, some of our models, like our recently released A10 twin 64 millimeter, they have crazy good performance, good vertical. But this little Citation is pretty darn impressive what it can do. And so, hey, Cody, do you have a battery in yours? Can you show everybody the
roots? You know, I don't have a battery in here,
man. Maybe Matt's got one there.
Oh, I'm just kidding. Prove me wrong.
Yeah. Like they were saying, the big thing about this airplane is, like a lot of our more modern ultramicros and even our other aircraft, we have a full set of relatively scale lights on here. So we've got not only the typical navigation lights, the green and the red on the wingtips, we also have some simulated strobes and beacons, and also landing lights on the belly, just like the full scale has. And when you have all those lights going, that allows you to fly a little bit later in the evening, a little bit earlier in the day. Even though you don't have as good of light out, you have better orientation because you have those lights installed. Yeah, look at that. There we go. Pretty cool.
Exactly. And the nice thing about this airplane is, you know, it's not a super dark colored airplane. So when you're flying at dusk, you see a lot of the white on the airplane, allowing you to fly at those later times or earlier times in the morning. And then again, like you said, the lights just continue to give you that orientation even more so. So it's a very easy airplane to fly even when it's dimmer out, shall we say.
You can even pull the landing gear off and hand launch it too. I mean, there's a lot of cool things you can do with this little airplane.
Yep, if you pull the landing gear off, it does have a little bit better performance, a little more speed, a little more vertical, and probably a little more flight time if you throttle back. And real quick, I saw some guys asking about the flight time, and that's going to be very dependent on your throttle usage or the battery that you're using. But if you fly this the way most people are going to fly it, you're probably going to see 6 to 7 minutes, as long as you have a good battery. So when you land, if you put 700-800 milliamp into your battery, your 800 milliamp battery, you're pushing it, and that's about, you know, probably going to get you that 6 to 7 minutes, give or take. You know, some guys are going to get a little bit less because they're going to fly around at full throttle more often. Basically, at about, let's say it's 12 amps at full throttle, that's about 15C on an 800 milliamp battery. And so even at full throttle, theoretically, you're going to get 3.5-4 minutes if you fly the whole flight full throttle. Now, again, most guys are going to throttle back a little bit on the backside of the loops. You know, they're going to do some slow flight here or there. So, again, I really think that 6 minutes plus is going to be typical for most people, which is great because that's like almost double the flight time most EEFs get.
Right. And, you know, if you throttle back at all, you're going to extend that. We did some testing and found that pretty much a wide open flight gives you a little over 4.5 minutes. So if you throttle back at all, you can easily extend that. And I want to say I've even got around 7 or 8 just doing scale flight. Again, right. You know, flying the pattern, doing gentle touch and goes, scale takeoffs, not getting really over half throttle much, if even that. And yeah, you can definitely make it fly a lot longer if you want to.
Yeah, and it's impressive because even at half throttle, it will loop from level flight, and you can get very long flight times at half throttle. I would not be surprised if we see reports of guys going 10 minutes plus. And a lot of those guys probably are going to be flying at that half throttle or less. But the nice thing is this airplane has that ability, and it's also relatively well-mannered even at low throttle settings. It's not got high wing loading. You have to be careful because it is a swept wing. So, you know, it is going to have like slightly different stall characteristics than a Hershey bar wing. But at the same time, you can cruise around pretty darn slow and turn pretty darn tight, especially if you use the rudder and you have coordinated turns and keep it in the air. So would you say that it's got better than you expected slow speed handling?
Absolutely. That's one of the challenges of doing a swept wing jet is usually the wing tips get very thin, so it's hard to make an airplane that isn't tip stalling a lot. You got to be very careful with what airfoil you choose, how much washout you put in the wing, various other aspects. However, I was pleasantly surprised with this airplane because
I think things cut out there for me for a few minutes. I don't know about you guys for a few seconds.
Given the amount of bandwidth that's happening in my neighborhood with everybody being home, yeah, I think my internet went out. So
yeah, it's Cody's fault. Darn you, Cody. So I think let's go back and kind of reiterate that point on tip stalls and whatnot. So one thing that I want to point out, because I don't think a lot of people realize this, but when you have an electric model in particular and you put in a bigger battery than what's recommended, you know, let's say we recommend an 800 for this thing and a guy sticks a 3-cell 1300 in there, you could probably shoehorn one in there if you wanted to and it will fly. But the reason we don't recommend heavier batteries, we don't want you to carry around a heavy low voltage battery alarm and things like that, is because, you know, a couple grand, like, you know, 15 grams on this airplane is a ton of weight. It's like 10% of the weight of the airplane. 30 grams is like, you know, almost 20% of the weight of the airplane. You don't want to be carrying around a bunch of extra weight because that will impact the wing loading and that will have a negative impact on the slow fly performance and then also on the stall characteristics. And then also if you have it nose heavy as well. So if you have it nose heavy, you have to tend to use a lot more up elevator on approach. And then that's when you can start getting into trouble for various different aerodynamic reasons. And so again, you want to make sure that A, you're not flying anything too heavy. And this is just across the board. This is not just this airplane. You want to make sure you're not too nose heavy. You want to make sure you're not too heavily loaded. So use a battery we recommend, use the CG we recommend, use the throws we recommend, and you should be fine.
Yeah, I mean, like I was saying, this airplane actually turned out to be more friendly, even in the stall, than I thought. Typically, the worst you're going to see if you're at, you know, higher altitudes and you pull the throttle back and slowly start feeding that elevator, it'll basically just do a light wing rock. It might change heading 90 degrees or so, but it never really flicks over. It kind of catches itself, which is nice.
Right.
So, yeah, as long as you're flying it the way we recommend in our manual, especially with the CG, it is a very good, well-mannered flying airplane that really doesn't have a lot of bad habits. It's kind of surprising how friendly it does fly.
Yes, it does fly very, very friendly, unless you get a little too overzealous and don't push down elevator anyway.
While inverted, while inverted, going full throttle,
But admittedly, the airplane is pretty darn tough. So even when you crash it, And I've seen a number of people now cartwheel it, a couple other things. And I mean, we've learned over the years from the UMX A10, for example, and then some other airplanes, we're now putting a lot more structure in the nose, especially when you got a big battery kind of hanging out there ahead of the wing. And we've got, if I'm not mistaken, you've got carbon rods in the nose and then also some kind of foam plate in there to help beef up the nose, correct?
Yeah, basically there's a couple carbon rods running down the whole length of the fuselage from the nose gear all the way back to behind the wing. And that's just, you know, to make the nose nice and strong. So if you do happen to bounce it or anything, you're not going to have the nose separate or cause a crack in the foam. It just makes it more durable too. You know, less flexing, makes the airplane more rigid and fly better.
Yes. And so I think, you know, guys, we learned, you know, we're not always perfect. The A10, none of us broke it during our development and our testing, but we noticed that when it got into kind of regular guys' hands and guys were flying on pretty thick grass or pretty lumpy surfaces, if they didn't keep the nose up on approach, they definitely ran into problems with breaking the nose off. And so I wouldn't have called the nose fragile myself. I see some people complained about that. But hey, guys, we learned from that. We addressed it in the Citation in particular to make sure the average person's not going to have those kind of problems. That said, be sure to check out the Flight Talk video that we have on our Horizon Hobby Products YouTube channel. And hey, real quick, I want to point this out. We actually have multiple YouTube channels. We have two YouTube channels for Horizon Hobby. Right now, we're live on the general Horizon Hobby YouTube. We also have Horizon Hobby Products YouTube channel. That channel is more focused on products versus the channel we're live on now is more focused on kind of like behind the scenes content, more in-depth content, like hints and tips and tricks. And in this case, we're doing a live interview with Matt. So make sure you subscribe to both channels. We also have a Spectrum RC channel in particular that a lot of guys don't know about. Make sure you check that channel out, because if you want to know how to program a 636 receiver or the new AR637T receiver, that channel has a ton of video content, talks about smart technology, all kinds of things, programming, IX20 setups, all those things are covered on the Spectrum RC YouTube channel. So again, make sure you subscribe to all these channels if you're interested in all these things, because otherwise you might miss out on some of that extra content.
So I do want to kind of address a question in the chat here. Foamboy RC has asked us multiple times, and I'm going to tell you right now, Foamboy, we really can't give you any answer. Our development process is always top secret. But his question is, I see on your Instagram page you posted a photo of the old UMX Habu. A lot of people in the comments really wanted you to bring it back, including me. Is there a chance it could? I want to give that question to Matt. What do you think, Matt?
Well, I will say nothing's impossible. There's always a chance we could bring it back better and improved, but just have to wait and see on that one.
True top secret document FBI personnel person. Awesome. I love it, Matt.
One thing we do want to point out when it comes to UMX EDFs in particular, you know, they came out many years ago, our first ones, the 2S powered MiG-15, then we had the UMX Habu, we had, of course, the A10 in the last couple of years. And since then, the expectation of performance in EDS has changed considerably. So none of those airplanes in kind of today's world meet the expectations of everyone. That's not to say they're not bad products. They're great airplanes. They all flew very, very well, especially for their times. But in order to get them kind of up to current levels, I think they really need to be maybe 30 millimeter fans and 3S batteries now. And not all those airplanes, for example, one of my all-time favorites, the UMX F-16, there's just no room to put a 3-cell battery in that thing.
Right.
And so as much as I'd love for us to bring that thing back in a 30 millimeter with 3S, it'd be awesome. Probably not going to happen. Again, like Matt said, nothing is impossible. But that said, I wouldn't expect us to always redo the old EDFs. You know, I think we're looking ahead to what could we do a little bit different without being too completely different, but also improving the performance and then also that user experience over time. So right. I would just say stay tuned.
Yeah, I think it's nice to have a variety of things too in our portfolio as well.
Oh yeah, and we always try to keep things kind of mixed up a bit. But that said, at the moment we don't have a sport jet like the Habu, and Habu was a great, great first jet. And to this day, I would still say the Habu is one of the very special designs that made jet flying possible for a lot of guys. Not necessarily the 80 millimeter composite fuselage ones. Those are very high performance jets. But if you guys remember the very first Habu, if I'm not mistaken, that was the gray foam one in Park Zone.
Yep, absolutely. Yep.
Hey, was that an EPO or was that EPS? I forget.
No, it was actually EPO. Great. And, you know, had the fixed gear, no flap, just a simple four-channel EDF that was just a hoot to fly. I mean, it was so fun. I remember when we'd go to various events, we get four or five of them in the air doing formation, just tight pack, doing low passes down the runway. I mean, it was a really, really enjoyable airplane to fly. Really, again, very friendly, easy to repair, used a simple battery. Wasn't much to it, but I'd say the same thing about like our original Parks on T-28. It was a simple thing, and that's what made it so popular. And then you had the performance on top of it. Hey, I'm flying a jet.
Yes. Did you work on that original Habu?
A little bit. It was kind of a group effort with a lot of us. A lot of us put in our feedback, and a lot of us flew it and, you know, tweaked on it here and there, and it became a really fun airplane.
That's very, very cool. So I would say, you know, for guys that don't realize this, that it's not always just one person behind every airplane. You know, I would say that Matt definitely was the guy behind the original Timber for sure. And then since then, we've had other Timbers come out, and Matt kind of helped start them. But then they did end up, you know, getting finished by other guys in particular. But, you know, that said, I think the foundation was laid by Matt for those. What's another airplane? I'll say this. What is your most favorite airplane outside the Timber and EC-1500 that you've developed for Horizon Hobby?
Good question.
Actually, this was asked a little while ago, but the Whippet actually is probably
up there. The Whippet.
We got it. All of us in the office basically got bit by the DLG bug. We all had the, you know, 1.5 meter composite airplanes that are, you know, crazy expensive. And man, if you broke it or launched or doinked it or something, it was just so painful because they're really, it's not easily repairable with the composites and the precision that those airplanes were made in. So I thought, you know, what would be a fun way to have a DLG, but that you don't have to spend $700 on just the airframe. And so I started thinking around, well, what if we just made a small little chuck glider? You know, I thought about how much fun it'd be when I was a kid, I'd build balsa wood chuck gliders and just go out in my backyard and just throw them until they broke and then build a different one. And that's, again, how I learned a lot of the aerodynamic principles. And so I started looking around what we had, and I had a champ wing, ultramicro champ. So I glued in a carbon spar and made, you know, carved a little foam pod and boom, Depron tail surfaces, used an ultra micro board from, I think, the same champ I got the wing from, and turned out it worked. And I went through a couple iterations of it and was able to have a ball with it, catch thermals. It actually flew really well. It was fun. And a lot of people saw me having so much fun with it, thought maybe this is a good project. And, you know, the great thing about it is about as simple as you can get. It is really a two-channel air elevator. Mm-hmm. So it made it very easy to fly. Even if you weren't doing the sidearm discus style launch, even doing just an overhand chuck and do a 360 and land at your feet. It was a fun airplane to work on, and to see kind of your own concept come to fruition was really amazing.
Yeah. So, you know, I would say that some guys have asked, is that stuff going to come back? And the market has shifted a bit, and we tend to kind of go with the trends of the market. And so I would say at this point, the best thing that you can do is, if you guys really love DLGs and you'd like to see them come back, just keep making those comments. We'd love to see more of that. And hey, real quick, I'm going to address a comment here. Laura Caldwell, which is probably not actually a legitimate name, but JPJI, when are you going to resolve your UK service issues? We've addressed this with you directly numerous times. We are not handling the service issues in the UK. That is handled by our distributor, Logic RC. And we will continue to delete your comments and hide you from our channels if you continue to constantly bring this issue up. We know that things did not go well in your particular circumstance. We tried our best to work with you. Sometimes things don't work out. You make comments on RC groups, on YouTube, on Facebook. You're not doing anybody any favors. To be honest, you're probably just doing more harm than good. You're making yourself look bad. We get tons of comments supporting us and against you in particular. So please do us all a favor and just let it go. If you do want to continue buying our product from the UK, again, work through Logic RC. That is our distributor in the UK. They are there to handle service issues, to address those for you and all the other customers in the UK. We were not able to sustain an office of our own over there because the market shrank. And so, you know, we did the best that we could. We tried to help you out. We're addressing your comments now. And if you continue to post on our channels, we will continue to delete them. We will continue to hide them. But hey, we've addressed it for you. We've done the best that we can. And I think most people would agree, we're offering pretty darn good service and better service than we ever have in the past in a lot of places. So anyway, back to the topic at hand. So Matt, one of the cool things about what your kind of past brought you to was you did a lot of kind of scratch building and true modeling. And that's something that I think a lot of guys don't know that very well. Do you have anything around you, behind you there maybe, that's like something that you scratch built?
Nothing right offhand. I mean, I got some, if you look up here, I can tilt this back. I got the Helio Courier that I built from one of the SIG 30-inch kits. It's basically a five-channel airplane. It's got flaps, lights, the leading edge slats work. It's got a full interior cockpit. That's one of them. I got a little 727 flat plate foamy I built there, hanging from the ceiling. Just a 1S power system, used just one of our little, you know, our old like T28 power systems from the 1S T28, and built a little profile airliner. And so I always love building things. Like I said, I think the thing that taught me the most about design, especially growing up when I was young and didn't have a lot of funds to get into art even, or was too young to do it, I would go to the hobby store and literally buy one sheet of 1/8-inch balsa and two sheets of 1/16, maybe once every week, once a week. And I'd bottle a CA and I'd sit there and build things. And I'd build airplanes I liked. I tried to make, you know, jets or gliders or whatever it may be that I was fancying me at the time, and go out and throw them around and go, wow, that, or tweak it, make it better the next round, because you know what you did wrong, and see if maybe I need to adjust the incidence. Maybe I need to make the tail bigger. Maybe I need to make the fuselage longer. It allowed you to experiment and learn what worked. And once you kind of figured out that little bit of a formula, you could really start having fun and play with some different designs, some different shapes. And again, just make some really fun little airplanes. And it teaches you a lot very inexpensively.
Mm-hmm. And that's something that I think, you know, not everybody is into that. Totally understandable. And I think that it is a good foundation as a product developer for you to have, because then you kind of know how to solve problems that are somewhat unusual, whether it's structure related or aerodynamic related. You've kind of done the trial and error method of education to learn what works, what doesn't work.
Exactly.
You've designed airplanes that did things really, really well and maybe didn't do something certain ways. And so you've since then kind of learned through experience, through some trial and error, kind of what works well and then what makes things better. And I see that all the time, because you're working in not only 2D CAD as a kind of a foundation, then you guys move into 3D CAD when you're developing a product, and you actually do some of the work in 3D CAD on the external and internal design. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, we're sitting there tweaking parts, moving stuff around, making it easier for the end consumer to use. You know, we try and make, we've done a lot of things, I think, recently that have made our products just simpler. You know, the hands-free servo connections, you know, like on the new 1.5 meter P51, you just take that outer wing panel, click, it's in, it's plugged in, it works. That's so much easier than having to fish a servo lead, or, oh, it fell into the wing, I got to dig it out with hemostats or pliers or something like that. Or, you know, even in the case of an airplane like the Timber, unfortunately, it's kind of a rat's nest in there when you take the wing off. You know, we're addressing that with, you know, like the EC1500. It has even more going on in it, with two motors and lights and flaps and ailerons. And that's just a nice plug-in simple wing now. So, you know, as we go forward, we try and progress and make things easier for the customer. And, you know, being able to dissect the airplane in 3D CAD, really cut it apart, you know, think about how you're going to use it and how it's going to come out of the box, how the customer's going to put it together, how they're going to use it going to the field or put it in their car. You know, those things we think about, you know, where is it going to get damaged? You know, a lot of the airplanes we put, like, for example, the Timber is a great one, where it has little plastic wingtip skids. So your wingtips, which are very thin, look nice over time. Because I'm a big hater of that, where you have a nice looking foamy and there's a little chunk torn off your wingtip, you know? So.
Yeah, and you did that on the Citation in particular. You put some really cool plastic winglets on there, because they curve up and they're relatively small, and they're relatively, you know, could be fragile if they were foam. They would have broken immediately, but they're plastic. They wrap around the bottom. They kind of integrate well. To be honest, I mean, aside from it being plastic versus foam, they look continuous all the way through. You can't really tell looking at pictures or in the air in particular.
And that's another one of the challenges. Even though, you know, you have photos of the real airplane, you have three views of the real airplane, trying to get that shape and three-dimensional to look right is a challenge, because that's a very complicated shape. And it took a number of rounds to get the winglets right. I found on one of the CNC samples when I was doing some type testing that, yeah, those winglets actually need to be tied in a little bit better because both of them fluttered off in a vertical dive.
No.
So, you know, that's why we kind of tied it into the bottom spar and added a little bit more meat to it, extended a little bit further in the wing to reduce that stress point. But, you know, we wanted to keep those protected and looking good because, like you mentioned, if they were foam, they're so thin, you bump the airplane, you're going to destroy that look of the airplane. So this keeps it looking good longer, protects it from damage or even, you know, landing damage. You have to get a little wing low on a landing. It'll scrape and not, you know, tear up the foam. So that makes it nice there, too.
Yeah, I think that's one of those things that you kind of, again, learned, experienced over time. And then through what you've learned in not only your kind of scratch building and your modeling skills, then also on the design side, you were able to 3D CAD those wingtips up and there they are.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's pretty cool. I'm not sure that everybody realizes that when we develop product, now we have many different developers and every developer kind of has like a specialized skill set. Now, generally speaking, you guys are all project managers. So you're kind of taking the product from concept to finished good. You go all the way from the original 2D CAD, 3D CAD, to the sample flying, to writing the manual. And then sometimes guys are more involved in the design process, but you're one of our guys that's more heavily involved in not only the 3D CAD, but then also in the flight testing and the tweaking of the aerodynamics of the airplane. One of the things that I think you've probably learned over the years is that when you're an experienced pilot, things fly a little different than they do for less experienced pilot, less capable pilots. And I think that's something that we're all kind of continuing to learn and develop too. And so, you know, for example, I don't know if anybody probably, well, some guys probably noticed this on the timber, but I think that you've noticed that if you're not careful with a certain amount of flaps, you kind of blank out the elevator to a degree. Is that something that that in the future, you, if you were to redesign the timber, you would almost design around if you could?
Absolutely. You know, and that was a little bit of a conscious decision when I was doing the original one. You know, one of the things that this airplane, the original timber, was designed for is flying off very rough surfaces, really tall grass, stuff that really a lot of other stuff just wouldn't fly off of. And one of the things I didn't want is a counterbalanced elevator, because with a lot of up elevator that is hanging below the stab, and if it gets caught on weeds, that can snap off. You have to make that reinforced then. It adds a lot more weight to the tail, which reduces performance. You're just adding weight to the airframe. So that one was a conscious decision to not have a counterbalance, which reduced the elevator area, which probably reduced its effectiveness a little bit. If I had to do it again, I would probably just make the elevator portion bigger. One of the things I wanted to play around with a little bit is taking a Timber X stab and putting it on turbo timber or original timber and seeing if that gives me that little bit extra authority with that larger surface area. It is shorter span, but it is more surface area. And, you know, that's a nice thing about the timber series, especially the foam one, is you can interchange parts. You can put a turbo wing on an X fuselage or an X tail on a turbo, or you can mix and match parts if you really want to kind of customize your airplane for how you want it to fly. But that'd probably be the one thing I would change. I would have made the movable portion of the elevator a bit bigger just to have that more authority.
Yeah, that's really cool, guys. So I kind of wanted you guys to hear an explanation like that, so you understand that we don't just come up with an airplane, make it fly okay, and then put it on the market and hope for the best. That not only Matt, but other product developers in particular, and even myself and Cody, we fly products and we have different levels of experience. We have different levels of background, different types of backgrounds. And our goal is always to come up with an airplane that kind of hits the meat of the market. It's really hard to make it super perfect for everyone. It's impossible, really. But we try our best to come up with kind of we think about these things. For example, not having the counterbalances on the elevator, so that way when you're flying in really rough grass and surfaces, you don't get them torn off. That would be a huge annoyance if you had to replace your stab constantly or repair that constantly. And again, most people probably haven't even noticed that they lose a little bit of elevator authority with full flaps on a timber. But that's something that we do, and I think that's something you as a skilled pilot, Matt, know, and then also as a skilled designer. You kind of know how to design around it, but you also know what it could cost you if you go that route.
Right. And then there's even the other side of that, to take it even one step further. If you make the elevator too big, you might have too much elevator authority, which now with full up elevator now makes the plane, you know, more snappy, more tip stally, ruins some of its low speed performance. So it's definitely a balancing act of trying to get the sizing right, the performance right, the control throws right, just so they feel balanced. You know, you don't want an airplane with really dead ailerons on a really hot elevator. That just is tricky to fly. It doesn't feel right. You kind of want to make everything kind of harmonious with your stick input, so it's easy to fly. That's one of the things that, that really helps. So you can definitely take it too far and go, well, I just want more elevator. Well, that could cause other problems in terms of, you know, like I said, bad handling characteristics at high elevators.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so again, guys, there's a lot that goes into every design that we release. It's not something that we just take lightly. We take a plane from some factory and slap our name on and sell it. Now, that happens on occasion. If we come across an airplane that we absolutely love the way it flies and we don't think there's a whole lot different we can do, but maybe one thing we can do is change the trim scheme, maybe put AS3X in there and Safe Select in there or something like that. Yeah, that happens on occasion. One of the questions I saw came through was, how many projects do you in particular have on your plate at any given time?
I would say typically it varies, of course, but it would be anywhere from 6 to 10, depending on where they are on the project and how important of a project it is. You know, something like a hobby zone trainer or like the apprentice is a big project because you want to get that right, because that's bringing people into the hobby. So that one can take a lot of your time to focus and tune and, you know, make sure all the safe and AS3X settings are exactly the way you want them, so that new pilot is very successful. While there's other projects that are, you know, not to put them down, but are more simple to do. They're not as complicated and don't require as much of your time. But again, it could be anywhere from 6 to 10, sometimes even more projects, depending on what you're doing. And again, occasionally it might be a refresh. You know, I worked with like the Hobby Zone Super Cub. I did a couple refreshes of that. That takes less time than a ground up design, of course. So you might have something on your plate that I wouldn't really consider a full project. You just have to do some work on them and you know, like you said, change the trim scheme on them, which is a little bit of a different scenario than picking up a different factor, you know, an airplane that's already kind of out there. But, you know, some of those projects are easier than others. And then there are some that are quite complicated. You know, the EC1500 was a very difficult project just because we were trying to put so much into it. It took a lot of testing, a lot of refining, a lot of tweaking to make it kind of this great all-around do-everything airplane.
So I just saw a question come through from Gypsy Salami. Is Park Zone officially dead? And I would like us to address that because, Matt, I think that was a brand that was particularly special to you at one point or another.
Absolutely. You know, when I was probably responsible for the majority of the 1.1 meter Warbird line, you know, the Corsair, the Spitfire, the Focke-Wulf, the Mosquito, the P-47, which is one of my favorites, you know, airplanes anyway. So to be able to do a model of one was phenomenal for me. And those airplanes were just so fun. They were so simple. You know, you could fly them four channel. You could put the optional retracts and optional flap servos and make them full house and have all that too. Or you could keep them light and simple. And it was a fun brand to work for. You could think of all these different things you can do to it for customers. I mean, I remember on the Corsair, we had an optional rough field landing gear. So yeah, retracts are out, but you can land a Corsair on rough grass. So, you know, things like that.
Yeah, and I will say this, guys, that the market and the world has changed since then, and we try our best to keep our finger on the pulse and to make sure that we're looking at things from a lot of different angles. So one of the things that happened in the last couple of years in particular, those 1.1 meter Warbirds were great airplanes. A lot of kind of detail, a little bit more performance. They wanted a little bit more functions, the lights, they wanted flaps, they wanted retracts. And unfortunately, those 1.1 meter airplanes didn't lend themselves well to that. So, you know, for example, we have our E-flite 1.2 meter Warbirds in particular, and or like our Cherokee 1.3 meter, which is a project that you worked on. And those airplanes have, you know, 3S and 4S compatible power systems oftentimes now. They have lights, they have flaps, they have retracts on, you know, depending on the subject matter. And those airplanes kind of outgrew park flying, to be honest. You know, a lot of those airplanes are not a lot bigger than a Park Zone airplane was, but they're big enough, they're powerful enough that if you're not a skilled pilot, you're going to struggle flying those in a park. And so on top of that, another thing that's changed in the last couple of years is that not everybody's able to fly at parks anymore. And so the whole concept of park flying has changed a bit. And so for that reason, yes, unfortunately, Park Zone is dead. That said, we're not opposed to bringing out park flyer-esque models under, say, our E-flite brand, for example. And so, you know, we're looking at some of the previous Park Zone airplanes that people loved and were near and dear to their hearts, and then seeing what we could do to make them more modern day performance. You know, for example, the old E-flite, it was Park Zone, then it was E-flite T28, then it was Park Zone again. I mean, that's just a phenomenal flying airplane, and it doesn't have retracts, it doesn't have flaps, it doesn't have lights, it doesn't have surface panel lines, it doesn't, it's just literally a fun scale T28. And it was a great Park Zone airplane. Exactly. In particular, you could literally fly it at a park. It was 3S, it was simple, but in the world today, guys, it just doesn't cut it. People want more. They either want more power, they want AS3X, they want safe, they want all the things that maybe Park Zone didn't have back in the day. And those things come sometimes at an added cost. And then also, again, makes them not necessarily the park flyer they once were. So I will say that I don't think all Park Zone airplanes are gone and dead forever. But Park Zone is a brand that unfortunately isn't going to be with us any longer. Yeah. So, hey, Matt, what was one of your other favorites? If I'm not mistaken, that Park Zone Wildcat, wasn't that one of your babies?
Yeah. Yeah, that one kind of was a surprising to me because it kind of developed a cult following. You know, people just who had it just loved it. And again, it was because it was so simple. It was almost like a hand launched version of the T28, if you will. Mm-hmm. You know, with that mid mounted wing, it made hand launch extremely easy, and it made it much easier to land too because you didn't worry about catching a wing tip or anything like that. And it looked the part. It was a fun little airplane. Again, it was a simplicity kind of ruled. That one did have some panel lines and some detail. But again, it was designed around simplicity and fun factor and just go out and play and not worry about it. You know, things like you were mentioning some of our airplanes that we have now under the E-flite line, like you actually mentioned Cherokee. I would say that's about as close as you're going to get on a 3S to kind of a park flyer that you would have seen in Park Zone, just because mm-hmm. it is super friendly. That Hershey bar wing makes it easy to fly. It's just, if you look at it now, it's much more scale than a Park Zone version of it would have been back then. You know, a Park Zone version probably wouldn't have had the full flying tail. It probably would have had much simpler detail on it, but it would probably fly relatively similar.
Right. Yeah. And so, guys, again, we're going to continue to, in the spirit of Park Zone, come out with airplanes that are along those lines because, you know, back in the day, it used to be you started with a Hobby Zone airplane, you went to a Park Zone airplane, then you went to an E-flite airplane. And those kind of got a little bit gray and a little bit fuzzy in between. And so there were E-flite airplanes. For example, the Timber is a great second airplane. Heck, many guys have learned to fly on Timbers. We don't personally recommend it. It can be done. But, you know, again, we kind of, I guess, blurred the lines, so to speak, between those brands to a point where Park Zone didn't really need to be there anymore. So, again, I think there might be some things in the future. You guys should definitely pay attention to our YouTube channel, Facebook, so on and so forth, because you never know.
Real quick, Jason. So Charlie asked, will spare parts be available for Park Zone models going forward or for much longer?
Some of them will be, yes. Not all of them are able to be produced anymore, but as many of them as we can, we'll keep them around. You know, that said, if you guys want to pick up some spare parts, I'd recommend doing it sooner than later because some of them, again, we can't produce the parts anymore. Either the tooling is no longer available or worn out. A lot of those airplanes, I don't think a lot of people realize that some of those airplanes are 8-10 years old. So, yeah, make sure you get parts for Park Zone if you wanted to get them. Now, again, some of them may come back in the future as other brand models, and so you may be able to get parts again, but I wouldn't bank on that. It's not going to be all of them. So, again, pick up spare parts while you can or pick up a spare airframe while you can. If you love them that much, it's one of those things where, hey, you know, not every airplane can be around forever. Some guys bring that point up. They're like, oh, you guys kill airplanes all the time. Well, first and foremost, we'll say this. When an airplane gets discontinued, it's for one reason in particular. Most of the time, it didn't sell well. That's the reality, guys. So if you guys think it was the best thing since sliced bread and we discontinued it, you may believe that, but the vast majority of the market unfortunately did not agree. And hey, we discontinue airplanes all the time that we were like, oh my gosh, this thing, we love this thing. Are we really? We have to get rid of it? And it's a business decision, guys. It's not by the heart. We can't say we love this airplane and we sell two of them a month, so we have to keep it forever. You know, when the MOQ is 2,000 pieces, and you're selling two a month, you can't afford to bring in 100-year supply. So we've learned our lessons on that over the years. In order to have enough room for new stuff, we got to get rid of the stuff that's not moving. And so sometimes we discontinue models for that reason. On occasion, other models like I think that Night Brave is a good example. The factory went out of business. We can't get them anymore, guys. We didn't necessarily want to discontinue it. It went out of business before we actually were able to get – we actually ordered a bunch of parts, and then they didn't fill the order. So we had airplanes and no parts. And that was a bad situation for us to be in because we're like, crap, we have all these airplanes. We could throw them away, but people want them. And so, yeah, we ran out of props before we ran out of airplanes. And, you know, that again, not a great situation. That was beyond our control. Similar situation with some of the Habaco brands, Top Flight ARFs in particular, Electrofly ARFs in particular, FlyZone. A lot of those factories didn't survive either a variety of things, but primarily the Habaco bankruptcy. And so those factories are no longer around. We can't even get those airplanes if we wanted to. So, yeah, guys, just know we don't do it because we don't know what we're doing, because we're crazy, because we are, think it's funny. It's nothing like that. It's always because there's a bigger, better business reason why. Hey, not everybody agrees with business relative to the heart, but sometimes, hey, well, not sometimes, always you got to pay the bills, right? So it's always something to keep in mind. Real quick, before we get too far down any other paths, I want to ask you a couple questions. My first question is this. If you had to pick one subject matter that we really don't, either we've never done or haven't done a lot of, and you really felt it was special, what would it be?
You know, that's a tough one because being at Horizon for the past, you know, 15 years, it's, we've done so much. You know, I mean, we've kind of covered almost every segment of the market. So, you know, all of us around there, around the building and stuff, have gotten to try kind of everything. You know, we've gotten to try sailplanes and scale stuff and jets and just about everything. So, you know, it's interesting to try and see what hasn't been done out there. And that's kind of one of our challenges always, is seeing what the next thing will be. For one particular thing, I don't know if I could do it. I don't know if there's one particular thing that, you know, it's just there's so many different avenues for this hobby, which make it so amazing. You can try so many ways to enjoy it, from simple stuff to very complicated high-end stuff. It's open for everybody and makes it great.
Well, aside from RC being one of your hobbies, let's tie it into something else that you do outside of RC. So what is something that you do in your free time?
So I am a little bit of a online flight simmer. Mm-hmm. So I got the setup. And, actually, basically, we fly airliners around the country. It sounds kind of boring, but it can get pretty intense when you actually have to make everything work the right way, like a real airplane does. So,
So based on that, do you think that you really wish we had an airliner or something along those lines?
Well, I will say I did heavily modify one of our old E-flite airliners, mm-hmm. with retracts and flaps and spoilers and lights, and had a lot of fun with that. So maybe we'll just leave that one there.
Yeah, maybe. We'll see someday. So I'll have to ask another question. What do you think of this airplane that a few people know? It's called the Draco. What do you think of that?
You know, being a lover of stole airplanes, the funny thing is I always thought the original radial powered Wilga was one of my least favorite airplanes. I'm going to say it because it's not an attractive airplane.
It's ugly.
However, what Mike did to that airplane, you know, putting the turboprop on it, just sleeking it up, adding the wing area, doing the crazy stuff, the way he just changed the airplane to be not what it started as is pretty incredible. And, you know, he started from a Wilga 2000, which was a piston engine airplane, ended up having an engine failure landing in a field somewhere. And that was kind of his genesis of, well, I'm going to make this thing killer. I'm just going to go to town on this thing. And yeah, it's an impressive airplane. I mean, going up to Oshkosh and seeing it in person was amazing. Seeing what I watched the YouTube videos of him building it and then see it in person up close to see the surface finish on his carbon parts, because the guy is a carbon maniac. It's a cool airplane. I really, really dig it. And, you know, I did the the turbo timber. I kind of have a thing for turbo props. I don't know what it is, but I just love the sleekness of a turboprop nose with the low intake and the exhaust stack sticking out the side. So, yeah, Draco is kind of a cool airplane.
Hence the turbo timber, right? That's kind of how we ended up there, because you like that turbo nose.
Yeah, yeah.
So I would say, you know, Draco is a cool airplane. I think everybody around the office has a special love for it. And I know a lot of guys keep asking us, are we going to make a Draco? So here, I'm going to throw this out to the audience. We did this the other night when we were on a Pilot Ryan's show. We talked about the Draco as a potential, you know, maybe an airplane we come out with someday. And we asked if there were three different sizes to choose from, which size would you guys choose? Would it be a UMX Draco? Would it be like a mid-sized Draco, like a 1.5 meter, kind of like a Turbo Timber, let's say? Or would you want something that's bigger, kind of like the Carbon Z Cessna, the Carbon Z Cub? Would you guys want a Draco in that size? So go ahead and respond in the comments here, guys. Which out of those three would you prefer that we make a Draco be?
I'm betting we get the same response. Yeah, I bet we get the same responses from Ryan's show.
I think so. Huge. Medium.
Huh? Somebody replied huge. I love it.
You can always throw out the Hangar 9 in there and make a giant one that fits a real turboprop if you want to go crazy.
That is true. If we made it, I don't know, like 3 meter, I think you could stick one of those 60-size turboprops in there, and the thing would probably have stupid power.
I'm with Sawyer here. He said make a blimp. Man, I'd love to have a blimp too. That'd be cool.
Make a blimp.
That'd be cool, man. Get a Horizon Hobby blimp. Make a blue. That'd be awesome.
You know, many, many, many years ago, I was very, very infatuated by RC blimps. And I do remember working with a guy who was flying around our college basketball arena. And there would be football games there. Hockey games inside there and some other NBA games and things like that. And so he had two of them. He had one that was just a regular blimp and then one that was a shark. Because back in the many, many years ago, I went to UNLV and it wasn't an official mascot, but we had – a coach of our basketball team named Tarkanian, and he was Tark the Shark. And so they used a shark to fly around. So it's a flying shark blimp. It was really cool, man. It was something else. But yeah, I don't know, man. Blimps are pretty limited in what they can do. Hard to say.
That's the purpose. You don't even got to put safe in it. It just sits there and floats and looks cool. You can throw some candy drops out of it. I can put Jason Sucks on it and fly it all around the department when we get back into the office. All kinds of cool stuff with that thing. We definitely need to get a blimp rolling out.
You could do that, and then I could also poke it with a pin, and then there would be no blimp.
You could do that, yes.
Or stab it with a knife or shoot it with a BB gun or I don't know, all kinds of things. Sticking them in the closet.
Sure, you're going to get a lot of stuff. We'll have to put FPV on it so I know who did it.
Fair enough. So, hey, that actually would be kind of cool. An FPV blimp in
the world. It'd be cool. You ship it with no air in it. They just have to throw some air in it and money sauce. Ship it.
Well, there you go, Matt. So if we decided we were going to do a Draco – and that maybe you were going to work on it. I think you got something to go on there and a little bit of, somebody wants a 3 meter. Some ideas there for you to noodle on while you're thinking about the next project or two or five, or I don't know, maybe you've been working on one and you haven't told us. It's hard to say. I guess people should just stay tuned, right?
Always.
Always, always, always. So is there anything else that you wanted to talk about, Matt, before we let you go? We don't keep you too long.
No, just glad to be on and glad to take time to talk about the Longitude. I think it's a really exciting project. I think it's something a little different from us. I think the performance is going to surprise people. It's definitely more capable than what you'd think it can be. And it might open up a lot of opportunities for us for a future UMX EDF. So always keep an eye out.
Yeah. Always keep your eye out, guys. And, again, Matt is one of our longest time developers, one of our longest time designers, does a lot of really cool things. And, make sure you check out some of his other designs. EC1500 is one of my personal favorites. And, for those that aren't aware, we did update the prop adapter and spinner design to make it easier to secure the props better. So that's out there. And then I'm trying to think of some of the other stuff you've worked on more recently. But basically what's some of the other ones that came out last year that you worked on?
V900 was it?
That's right.
Kind of opposite end of the spectrum from a Stoll airplane, but.
Yep, that's right. So Matt's done pretty much one of our slowest flying airplanes and also one of our fastest flying airplanes. That's pretty darn cool. Not a lot of people can say. In fact, I'm not sure anybody else in the office can say they've done both those things.
Right. And Matt, when this is over, I'll be by to pick up those models that you built just above you there. I'd let you have them for the show, just to show. I need those back when this is over.
All right.
That's cool. Well, so I guess we've got a fair number of people still online here watching us live, but we can let you go, Matt, and you can enjoy the rest of your Friday afternoon. I'm sure you got some other design and development work to do before you call it a day, but you're welcome to sign off, and we can Cody and I can keep chatting with the crowd here, do a little bit more of a hangout for another maybe 15, 30 minutes or so, depending on how long people stick around and what their questions are. But thanks again for joining us, Matt. We really appreciate it. And hey, for guys that aren't on RC groups, make sure you check out RC groups, because Matt's on there, I'm on there, Cody's on there. That's a great place to kind of interact with us in the thread specific to each model in particular. And then at the same time, of course, you guys are welcome to post comments on this video and then any other videos that, you know, for the products that Matt's worked on, the Citation. Again, be sure to check out the Citation, our regular launch video, also the flight talk video in particular, because we show you how to hand launch and land it. It's not a hard or difficult airplane to hand launch or land, but it's still nice to see it done firsthand. So, you know, I will say this, though. I've been very, very happy with the way that airplane. It's fantastic. Everything about it, the way it looks, the way it flies.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, you did a great job once again, Matt, as always.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And just a quick mention, we actually will be having a real flight flying with Juan Pablo Montoya in about 45 minutes. So take a peek out for that, and you'll see some of us playing RC online.
That's right. Matt will be there. A couple other guys from the office will be there, including Juan Pablo Montoya, the race car driver. So that starts at 5 o'clock Central Time. So 6 o'clock Eastern and 3 o'clock Pacific Time. It'll be on Facebook, live on Facebook in particular. So be sure to check out our Horizon Hobby Facebook page to see that. And hey, you guys can watch Matt. And I'm sure, Matt, hey, you're going to fly the EC1500 on there?
Probably at least once.
All right. Fair enough. Sounds good. All right, man. Thanks again for joining us. Feel free to sign off when you're ready.
Yep. Thanks, Matt.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
I see someone said, how do I join? And so that will be a closed flying session for just the guys that are involved from Horizon Hobby and our special guest, Juan Pablo Montoya. So you will be able to watch that live. There will be some commentary. Steve Petrato will be kind of giving you guys some details of who's flying and what they're flying. Give you some background on each individual, and then let each individual speak as well. The models that they're flying, how they're flying it, what they're doing, so on and so forth. So be sure to check that out. RC Air Marshal, what are y'all doing with JPM? So for those that don't know, Juan Pablo Montoya has actually been someone that we've worked with for a number of years now. We've sponsored his race car for a while because he's always been very interested in radio controlled, and he's actually always been a big fan of Horizon Hobby products. So years ago, he came to us and said, hey, let's work together. And so it's been pretty cool. You guys can see on his current car, there's Horizon Hobby on the side of it. It's pretty darn cool. So be sure to check that out. And he reaches a whole different audience than we typically do, because he has a lot of fans worldwide, and that's really, really cool to see. So he's a cool guy and actually a really good pilot. For those that haven't seen him fly, you can check him out on the Real Flight Live that we'll have a little bit later here. And I might be able to join. You guys probably haven't really noticed, but I'm actually under the weather. I've not been feeling particularly well the last 24 hours. Making it through this so far, I did take some cold medicine before I jumped on, and I drank some kombucha or whatever.
What is that?
It's like fermented tea or something, and has live probiotics in it or something like, I don't know. It smells not good. And there's an aftertaste to it. And so I got to say, it was recommended to me by people, and I happen to have it in my fridge from months ago. And although I feel better now and I'm able to talk, so I guess that's an improvement. Yeah. You know, but that said, yeah, I have it. GB Linden loves it. You really? I don't, maybe I have the wrong kind. Maybe there's flavors, but man, I'm going to have to try. No, and RC Air Marshal, I don't got the Rona. I'm pretty sure I don't got the Rona.
Yeah.
I have to fly
with him next week, so he better not have that. I'll have to go out there in a suit.
Well, you know, you just stay 6 feet away from me and don't let me cough on you.
600 feet away from you.
600 feet away
from across the field.
Just zoom in a lot. Yeah, you could do that. Yeah, see, RC Air Marshal, it's disgusting. Well, I mean, okay, I wouldn't say it's the best tasting thing or the worst tasting thing I've ever had, and I'm guessing there's many different kinds, but
yeah.
Yeah, Yeah.
So, guys, while we're here hanging out, does anybody have any specific questions that they've been wanted answered?
Here's some. Beach D18.
A beach would be cool. I'm not going to lie. Beach. Scale beach would be kind of cool.
That would be cool, actually. Somebody said a blimp with a hole in it would look like a heli flying 3D. That's pretty good. I like that.
I'm telling you, the blimp idea is there, man. Somebody's going to do it and make a killing. It should be.
It's been done. It's never really taken off.
Been done at a hobby grade level, man. You're talking about the little shark one that had a weight and the tail moved and a kid's birthday
party. That was a toy. That was there, but there were hobby.
Here's what you do. You get a small one. You put the Inductrix flight controller in there, the Inductrix little pods, and you make a small, 24-inch model. It'd be perfect.
Listen, man, I know you got plenty. Why don't you do that? And then bring it to the office. And if it works good and looks good, maybe we got something.
Yeah, well, that's actually a good idea. I might have to do that.
Yeah, I believe it.
I love it. It's perfect.
I believe it when I see it. Oh, one thing, Brian Donaldson, I just saw a question pop up. What's the replacement for the AR-636 receiver? So real quick, overarching explanation of the 636. And actually, a lot of our older UMX airplanes, our older receivers, even older version transmitters used the original Spectrum chip. That chip is no longer in production. Now, we do have some supply of those to last us for a while, but not indefinitely. We are going to run out of them at some point. And so over the last couple months in particular, we've been transitioning to new model receivers, control units, transmitters that have that new chip installed. Now, the great thing about the new Spectrum chip, it costs a little bit more. That's a downside. But the plus side is we can do a lot more with it. Not only can we improve RF potentially performance overall, but also we now have telemetry that we're able to use more effectively. So we can have 2-way telemetry, we can have full range telemetry built into the receiver on some of our new receivers. So in the end, the 637T kind of sort of replaces the 636 long term. The 637 is a different animal though. It's a whole lot more receiver. It's got full range telemetry. So as far as you control your plane, you've got telemetry coming back. If you have a smart ESC, that telemetry can be motor RPM, temperature of the ESC. If you use a smart battery with it, that's going to be the temperature of the battery, the individual cell voltages, like a lot of really cool data comes back through that, that receiver with a compatible transmitter. That said, in the short term, we've come up with a plan to make sure that we still have 636s available. Now, I don't know if everybody knows this, but there was the AR-636, there was an AR-636A, there was an AR-636B. Kind of in a nutshell, the AR-636 was the full feature open stock version. That was the one that we sold separately for $79.99. A lot of guys bought it and put it in stuff. And that had a satellite receiver port. So you could use the receiver by itself, or you could plug in a remote receiver to have additional path diversity and additional redundancy in your receiver system. The AR-636A was kind of sort of a lockdown version of the 636. It was programmed for a particular airplane. You couldn't change it, in a nutshell. AR-636B is what the vast majority of our airplanes have now. That does not have that satellite receiver port. So it's a little bit simplified over a full version 636. However, it's not locked down. So if it comes with your P-51 1.2 meter Mustang, you can actually take that receiver out and reprogram it to use in another airplane. And that's something I want to point out. I'm really surprised to find this out sometimes. I guess I shouldn't be, but a lot of guys will pull a 636 receiver out of an airplane and put it in another airplane. Seems like it's okay, right? The problem is the AS3X and safe select settings in that receiver were tuned for whatever model it came out of. You put it in another model, and even if your elevator's going the right way and your ailerons are going the right way because you set the servo reversing in your transmitter as such, the AS3X and the safe could be going opposite of what you want, and it will crash your airplane. That has happened time and time and time again. So yes, you can use a 636B or whatever receiver in a different airplane, but you must reprogram it. You have a couple of options. You can plug it into a computer using that programmer through USB. You can buy the Bluetooth module and plug it into the receiver so you can program it through your phone app. There's many different options, but you have to reprogram it to use it.
Right.
That said, in the longer term, I'd say in the next year to 2 years, we're still going to have 636s available. However, we have stopped making the AR-636. We're no longer producing those. We have continued to produce the AR-636B. We will begin offering that receiver separately. Probably next week, you'll see it pop up on our website. So if you have an airplane that has a 636B in it, a good example being our recently released A-10, you will be able to buy a new receiver for it if you ever need one. It'll be the 636B. It's about $5 less than the 636 was because it doesn't have that extra port for the satellite receiver. And we're going to have those for probably a year or two, give or take. And then longer term, the 637 will replace the 636. And the reason for that is because we just won't be able to make the 636s forever. The 637 we can, at the moment, make indefinitely because it uses the new chip. And one thing I will point out is that the foundational software and programming of a 637 is very different than a 636. One beautiful thing about a 637 is you can use forward programming on your transmitter. You can now program AS3X and safe settings from your transmitter. You will not need a programmer. You won't have to plug it into your computer. You won't have to plug it into a Bluetooth module and connect to an app on your phone. You will be able to program it right on your transmitter, but that's why the values and the setup is going to be different than a 636. You won't be able to take a 637 and drop it in place of a 636 and load the 636 profile into the 637. However, we will provide down the road all the data points that you need to, say, put a 637 into a turbo timber, for example. Right. Because long term, a couple of years from now, you won't be able to get a 636 and you may still have a timber and you may crash it and damage your receiver or whatever and need to put a 637 in. Boom, we'll provide the details for it. So long story short, 636s will be around short term, but not forever. Again, the B version will be available on our website starting again next week. And our product support guys, just so you know, they have a stock of these as well separate. And if you ever need one, they can program it and send it out to you for service needs.
Right. I also want to touch on that just a little bit, guys. So the AR-637 or the AR-636A, on the majority of the newer aircraft, those are also reprogrammable. So as long as you have the interface cable and whatnot for your computer, you can reprogram those. There was a few models in the earlier version of that receiver's life, like the Sukhoi, the blue one, the Gen 2, as well as the Corsair was safe. Those older E-flite models, those were locked. But every model thereafter, we've made it to where you actually can reprogram those receivers as well as the AR-636B receivers going forward.
Yes, so it's not, it probably wasn't as clearly defined as it should have been, which A model ones weren't programmable. And a lot of guys kind of generalize that all 636s can't be reprogrammed. That's not true. Just some of the A's can be or cannot be. And so I recommend that, generally speaking, if you have a B, you're good to go, but make sure you reprogram it to use it in your new airplane. Don't just stick it in a plane and go, oh, the elevator's going the right way. It's got to be right. Right. You can actually check safe in AS3X and make sure they're going the right way, but most people don't do that, and they'll take off with safe turned on, and if the elevator is going the wrong way, instead of trying to get the nose down, it's going to keep going up until it potentially crashes. So, right.
And just another tip as well for the inexperienced user who's using the programmer for the first time, if you're just wanting to play around in there and see what's going on, when you first connect that receiver to your computer and you power it up, it's going to give you a message right on the front for the very first screen that says, do you want to use computer settings or do you want to use receiver settings? If you click on use computer settings, you've just wiped out everything in that receiver. So make sure you remember that that's a very important tip. If you click on use computer settings, you just lost everything. And then now at that point, you'd have to go to Spectrum RC, download the file if it's available, which most of the times they are, download the file directly back to the receiver. You basically have created an extra step for yourself. So just try not to do that or just do some research and watch some of our how-to videos before you jump into there for the first time.
Yes. Yes. So yeah, again, you can basically reset it using the default programming from the computer if you choose that setting. And so watch out for that. But again, if it happens and you pulled it out of an airplane and you want to put it, or it's already in the airplane and you just want to put that same file back in, go to Spectrum RC's website. You can download that file and load it into that receiver. Or let's say you take it from one Horizon Hobby airplane and put it in another one that was also available in a bind and fly version with an AR-636, you can download that software file and put it into that receiver as well. That's the easiest and safest way to do it. That's an option. I see a couple of questions popped up here. Mark Dibble, he mentioned the satellite solder pads are still there on the AR-636A and B. That's true. You solder a satellite to it and it powers up with the LED, but how can you know if the satellite is still receiving data? Basically, if the power, if the light is on, it's working, and the hardware just wasn't there. The software is there for the satellite receiver to work. So some guys have done that. They've cut a hole in the case. You know, they've ran the wires into there, soldered it down to the PCB. Of course, we don't recommend it officially. We can't warranty a receiver that a guy has modified in that way. But right. If you do it, it works.
Right. Chip Mitchell also asked, can he run a 637 in the new OV10 Bronco? So, Chip, if you're running a newer Spectrum transmitter, DX6, 6E, 8, 80, 9, all on the latest generation of firmware, the answer to your question is yes. So, as Jason had mentioned, it's a forward programming setup. So, once you put the receiver in the aircraft and you get it, you know, completely firm, locked down, you're going to want to use a good piece of double-sided sticky tape to hold it in place. And you've got all your connections plugged in where they're supposed to go. You'll bind to the receiver. You'll have a new menu that appears on the very first screen of your transmitter. So when you click on the scroll wheel, that's going to put you onto the function list. And then as you scroll down, you're going to see a new menu there literally called forward programming. Mm. When you click on that menu, it's very user-friendly. It's going to have like a step one, step two, step three. It'll ask you questions like, is this a sport aircraft or is this a trainer aircraft? And when you choose one or the other, it gives you a preset, you know, gain value that you could use to experiment with. And then you can adjust from there. It's very straightforward, very easy to use. Again, it's kind of like a step-by-step. It's really difficult to make mistakes in there. So yes, you could use it in the OV10, yes.
Yes, yes. And then kind of staying on this receiver path that we're on, GB Linden did ask, the most recent AR620 has a smart logo, as does the 410. The 637, of course, also has that. So the receivers themselves aren't necessarily smart receivers. However, they are smart technology compatible. What that means is if you have a smart ESC, which we just recently came out with in the Spectrum line, and you plug it into one of those smart capable receivers, they will transmit telemetry back to the transmitter just as you know you would expect. If you plug it into a 636, for example, it will not work. So any of our older generation receivers that use the older chip, the 636, the 610, the AR400, those are not smart compatible. That's why they don't have a smart logo on them. Now, the 410 and the 620, you do have to update to the latest software if you happen to buy them like, you know, a year ago or 6 months ago. If you bought it in the last couple months, they'll already be updated to where they're completely functional with smart. But that is something you have to watch out for. So again, if the ESC has smart on it, that means it's smart technology compatible. So it will work with a smart ESC to get you that data. And in addition to that, I think it's already giving you the fades and holds and everything telemetry-wise as well. So, you know, you're going to get that already, but you get the additional smart telemetry data as well out of that. So,
right.
RC Life, please make a pattern airplane. I love pattern airplanes. I think they're the best looking airplanes. They usually fly pretty darn good. Maybe. I wouldn't say no forever, but at the moment, the world is not super enamored by pattern airplanes, but we're going to keep our finger on the pulse and see how things happen. I will say this, though. Some of our airplanes fly like dang pattern airplanes. Our E-flite P-39 1.2-meter airplane, and I've flown a lot of pattern airplanes, it flies like a pattern airplane. It is freaking phenomenal. And it's not just that airplane. We have some other airplanes that fly like pattern airplanes, too, like our Commander MPD 1.4-meter. Just sweet handling airplanes. Now, granted, they're not as symmetrical as a pattern airplane would be with a fully symmetrical airfoil and, you know, a 000 thrust to wing to stab lineup and so on and so forth. But again, I wouldn't say never, but maybe nothing anytime soon.
So Cruz Schroeder, was there ever a known issue with the Cirrus SR-22T? Have had issues with the motor stalling, like a loose magnet. Had it warrantied, but it seems to keep happening. So Cruz, in that situation, motors generally don't fail that often. So if you've had one replaced and it's failing consistently, I would maybe start taking a look at your speed controller and maybe replace that and see if the situation continues.
Yeah, that is odd. That definitely was not a typical problem. You know, you may come across a couple people that have the same problem, especially if you post on, say, RC groups, because a lot of people that have problems will tend to post about it. But I can say we've sold a lot of those Cirrus airplanes.
It's been pretty good.
Yeah. We typically, when something goes above like a typical failure rate threshold of like, you know, 0.5% or 1%, that is when it becomes a widespread known issue, and that's when we address it. And again, nothing that I've ever seen is indicated that that airplane has any significant number of problems at all.
Right.
So,
David Boyder, he has the twin otter, loves the plane, flies well. Only topic I have trouble with is on landings. It seems to hop a lot when on floats. It doesn't flare well with full flaps. David, I don't know what your experience level is. Jason, you've got a lot of personal time on the twin otter. Yes. Did you have any issues either A on floats or B with flaring on that particular airplane?
Yes, if I don't know if he was tuned in earlier in the conversation with Matt when we were talking about the timber with full flaps will blank the elevator. A very similar situation will happen with the otter. It has to do with the position of the flaps relative to the stab, and the it's somewhat dependent on CG as well. So if you have the CG kind of nose heavy, if you're using a bigger battery in particular, that's also going to be problematic. But generally speaking, my recommendation to kind of minimize that bouncing, to kind of make sure that you've got good elevator authority, is instead of using kind of the full flap travel, try something a little less than that. You might want to fine tune it. You can probably carry more than the takeoff flaps or the, you know, partial flap position, but not exactly the full flap position. Even flying on ground, I found that if I used that full flap and had a nose heavy situation, I had a hard time getting the thing to flare out to where it would come down pretty fast, relatively speaking, and would bounce. So that's, I think, what you're running into, because generally speaking, when you got the CG right, you kind of come in at the right angle of attack and the right airspeed, that thing comes in really sweet and just sets down like a full scale. It's a beautiful thing. So try that. Try less flap. First off, try your takeoff flap setting, whatever that is, or your partial flap setting, and I bet you'll already see an improvement. And then if you do, just keep lowering your landing flap or your full flap until you kind of find a sweet spot or a happy medium for that.
Very cool. Altitude Gauge RC. How do you decide what brand releases what product? I recall the composite Habu 32X was E-flite. Today, would that be more of a Hangar 9 release? See, that's a pretty good question. I'll let Jason answer that one.
Yeah. So over the years, we've certainly blurred the lines and brands for various things. But I will say this, that I think that Habu jet, which is electric powered only, is an E-flite airplane. Although it is, so one of the interesting things about E-flite as a brand is it's a very broad brand. We have everything in E-flite from trainers to high performance. In that case, we back in the day had the high performance Habu EDS. We still have our foamy EDS now, the SU-30 being kind of king of the hill right now. Obviously, there's some other high performance ones in there. And what's nice about E-flite is it kind of allows us to give you kind of the best with electric performance, whether it's the best trainer in the Apprentice STS or it's the best Ultra Micro with the UMX Citation or whatever it is. So it makes sense that the Habu as an electric-only model belonged in E-flite. Whether or not it's composite and wood, I know some guys kind of are hung up on the whole E-flite is foamies thing. That's not true. When we started E-flite, the intent was not that it would just be foam airplanes. We originally had E-flite everything, balsa, foamies, carbon, flat foamies, all kinds of things. And so that said, you know, over the last couple of years, the market has shifted to being more interested in fully molded foam airplanes because you can get really sexy shapes out of foam. And you can put panel lines in them and rivets in them and all kinds of scale details. So the market's kind of gone a lot towards, I want scale. I want super detailed. I want foam. Maybe they don't want foam per se, but inherently you have to get foam. So at any rate, I would say that in the future, we would certainly look at having models like that again, maybe in E-flite. But if it was a little bit bigger and you could put a turbine in it, then maybe it would be more of a Hangar 9 airplane.
Right.
Because Hangar 9 is intended to be not just electric. You can have Hangar 9 airplanes that are electric and or gas or glow, or in this case, we'd be talking about a mini turbine. And so, like, let's say we made a Habu, I don't know, 90 millimeter Habu, and you could put a King Tech 45 in it or 60 in it. I would say that could very well be maybe a Hangar 9 airplane. Even that said, because it would still probably fall into more electric usage, it would probably be an E-flite airplane. But if we did an even bigger one, like let's say we did a 100 size turbine Habu, you could put 120 millimeter EDF in there, 110 right. millimeter EDF in there, but I bet most guys wouldn't. And that would definitely make it probably more of a Hangar 9 airplane, so to speak.
Right. Samantha Badley, we missed her question earlier. She wants to know, or she or he wants to know if we are going to have a bigger, more powerful smart AC or DC charger. I'm not sure how much more powerful you would need than the one we already have, the 500 watt S1500 DC charger that we currently have. That thing is.
Well, I think the question is more like a built-in AC/DC, so kind of like the S2100,
where you've got
the power supply built in. So I'll speak to that. That the S2100 is very unique. Actually, pulled the power supply out of that thing. It is a very, very compact AC power supply, but it's very expensive. So if you wanted more than 200, so that charger is cool because even though it has two ports that are 100 watts each, you can shift the power to one port and have 200 watts on one port. So I don't know that a lot of people know that, but you can do that. Now, if you need more than 200 watts of power, you would say want the S1500 charger, which is a 500 watt charger. And then you also are going to need a 500 plus watt power supply. So in this case, if you really want an AC/DC solution, you're not going to be able to find a higher than 200 watt AC built-in power supply. You're going to have to buy a separate power supply and a separate DC charger. And then, of course, the DC charger, you can use it on its own at the field in the small package that it is plugged into a battery or a power supply at the field. And then you would use the power supply at home. And so that's what I do is I tend to have my power supply on my bench. I plug in my DC charger when I want to use it at home. And then when I go to the field, I just leave the power supply at the house and I take the charger with me to the field. And I either use a power supply there that somebody has or I hook it up to my car battery and go from there.
Right.
But at the moment, there are no plans for higher than the S2100 because that's already 200 watt capable power supply. And it's like a 240 watt power supply or something in there.
Right.
And it's in it would be very expensive and it would still be a very large unit to have an AC/DC one.
Right. Right. RC Life, I've been having problems with my UMix timber where if I go too low or idle throttle, all the control surfaces don't work and I can't control it. So a question for you, does full throttle work and you still have control? Because that would be odd. Just curious there.
Yeah.
Also, there is an LED light on the flight controller that indicates whether or not you're connected to your transmitter. So when you have the timber sitting level and upright, your transmitter on, you're working the surfaces, everything's working as it should, you'll notice there's a red solid light on the flight controller. And if were you to turn off your transmitter right then and there, that light would go off to indicate that you've lost signal. So my question is when this is happening, does that light shut off? Because if it is, it could be one of two things. It could be that you're having a receiver issue, either that or something maybe going on inside your transmitter. And to test that, you could try your transmitter to other models and make sure your transmitter is okay. But if it's on the flight controller, you may need a new flight controller. It could also be your battery. The cells in your battery could be weak, could be failing, could be going out. And that could also, again, take power away from the flight controller. So definitely need more information from you there. And again, if we can't answer it here, we would be happy to address it with our product support team. You could reach out to them anytime, Monday through Friday, 8 to 6 p.m. Central Standard Time.
So on that note, somewhat related, and again, I also agree. I think it's if it's doing it at part throttle but not at full throttle, that's very strange. And so it is probably not normal, not typical. Mark Dibble asked, the UMX timber was created because of chat spamming, right? No one ever asked for the UMX timber before we came out with it. To be honest, I remember pretty vividly the day that we discussed it, and a number of people in the room were like, I don't know about that. I don't know if that can be a thing. And I know Matt got excited. He's like, yeah, man, let's try it. Let's do it. Because over the years, we've had some pretty good ultra micro airplanes, like, for example, the Carbon Cub SS that we had back in the day, which had flaps and it had lights, but it flew kind of heavy. And so the reason the UMX timber is the size that it is because we wanted it to be very stall capable. And Matt did some cool things with that airplane. He actually did change the proportions slightly. So it has a little bit more wing area and larger ailerons, larger flaps, because at the smaller size, lower Reynolds numbers, it does have different handling than the full size one had. So, you know, that said, since then, we have seen a lot of, I wouldn't say chat spamming per se, but definitely a lot of chat comments in various places about UMX Timber X. And hey, we hear you guys. It's not as simple as you think. You know, you can't just take the guts out of a UMX Timber or UMX Turbo Timber, stick them in a similar scale Timber X and have it work well. We're trying things, maybe someday, possibly, but hey, I will say this. If there's enough comments over and over and over about anything, we pay attention. We do not ignore you forever. So there's times when we can't do it or it's never going to happen or it's not a practicality. But there's been a couple of things over the last couple of years where keep hearing it and we're like, well, dang it, man. People keep asking for it. We better darn do it.
So RC Life asked, what do I check my transmitter connection with the UMX Timber? So again, when you're bound, RC Life, when you have connected your transmitter to the airplane, you have some control. There's a solid light on the flight controller or on the inside of the aircraft. That's the chip that you're plugging your battery into on the airplane. When it's bound to your transmitter, there'll be a solid light. When you're losing control, I need to know if that light shuts off or not. That'll give me a lot of information as to what's going on.
Yes.
Let's see what else we have here.
Ooh, so many questions. I like this. Hey, I gotta say, guys, now that we're kind of working from home at the moment, we actually came across some pretty cool software that allows us to stream live on YouTube and Facebook at the same time. And what's cool is it shows us all of your comments at one place. It's fantastic.
Right. It is neat.
And I can watch it and Cody can watch it and we can bounce back and forth on these questions. It's pretty darn cool. I gotta say,
absolutely.
I'm impressed.
It's good. It's good. It's set up well. But I don't know how to pronounce this. I might kill it. It's a Bajiba Nation. When will the SU-30s be back in stock? Man, I want one myself. That airplane has been sold out since its release. It's been hugely popular. Jason, I think we're hoping to have some here towards the beginning of summer, I think, is what our goal is. Is that right?
For the SU-30?
Yeah.
Yes. So there are more on the way very shortly here. And so if you want one, I would strongly recommend backordering them. So I'll say this. It is a relatively complex airplane for the factory to assemble. It takes longer to build than your typical aircraft. So, and then it is relatively large and expensive, so we don't bring in a ton of them at a time. And so it probably will continue to be in short supply for a while. I think it did even better than we expected. You know, we thought maybe people would go, it's Russian. It's $550. It's this or it's that. But I got to say, guys, I mean, it's even when I first saw it, I was skeptical. But then I flew it. I was like, I get it now. Cool. It flies really good. It's so locked in. There's not a lot of airplanes that fly as solid as that airplane flies. And it's in part because of the subject matter, the plane form. But then also with AS3X, man, that thing is just dialed. It's absolutely dialed. And I know some guys that are flying without AS3X that say it's dialed. I got to tell you guys, if you ever try AS3X in that thing, holy crap. It is like flying a giant scale turbine model. It is fantastic.
So, Jason, something that we ran into as well on the A10, can you advise the best battery position for the 3,200 milliamp hour 6S pack on the A10? Where is the best way to position it?
It is somewhat personal preference, but I will say where I like it is actually behind that front strap. So I don't use the front strap. I have it set so the front of it is basically, or the end of the battery is right behind that front strap. And some people may say that's a little on the tail heavy side. Some people may say that's still nose heavy. It is personal preference. I don't mind an airplane being a little bit nose heavy, but I do mind it being a lot nose heavy because then I need to carry a lot of up trim. And when I roll inverted, it's hunting the ground. And then on approach, I have to keep a lot of elevator into it. And you sometimes can run out of elevator. So I do strongly recommend finding what you prefer personally. But also will say that you can move that battery pretty darn far back on the A10 and it's not going to get you into a world of trouble. You don't want to be tail heavy, of course, but you can probably put that battery further back than you've been putting it and you'll be fine. I don't think you'll have any issues with that. And so the 4,000, I run even further back. First couple of times I flew it, I had the 4,000 also up against that front strap. But now I will fly with it further back than that.
Right. Let's see, Brad Butler, if I had been flying the E-flite F-16, the Viper, as well as the Arrows Marlin, am I ready for the E-flite F-18? I would say yeah, man. What do you think, Jason?
Yes and no, I'll say that. The F-18 is unique. It's very, very – now, I'll say flying it in the air, no issue. Now that you've flown all those jets, you're going to have no problem with the handling in the air. There's two things you got to watch out for. The number one thing is takeoff. You must use flaps. Because of how that airplane sits, because of how the landing gear is cantilevered and the way it works, it will not rotate like your typical airplane. You absolutely need to have the flaps in there to add the lift to kind of get it light on the mains to where you can kind of rotate and fly off. So that's something that's a little unusual. I mean, granted, you're probably taking off with flaps with your other airplane, so it's not a big deal. But I use full flaps on takeoff now. First couple times I flew it, first flight, I actually used no flaps. And I was like, oh my gosh, I don't think it's ever going to get off the ground. And then I asked the product developers to go, yeah, dude, you definitely need to use flaps. And then I also watched some other guys fly some larger scale F-18 turbine models, and I noticed they were all using flaps. So that's one issue. Number two is it is draggy. So in the air, you're going to feel that, but that's kind of F-16-esque, where when you do a tight turn, it's going to slow down a lot. It's going to kind of like, because it has a full flying stab, kind of push and drag the butt a little bit, which I think is cool. But that drag can bite you on landing. You must land with flaps, of course, unless you have a super duper long runway. You're going to have to carry a lot of throttle, more than you're used to carrying. The Viper, probably the Arrows, Marlin, the you can land those with very little throttle or no throttle, really, even on final approach. The F-16, depending on how you land, if you land at high alpha, you're landing with probably some throttle. The F-18, you're going to have to land with more throttle than all those. If I recall correctly, you know, most of the time when I'm making my approach, I'm at least half throttle, if not two-thirds throttle. And I'm bringing that down nose high, nose high, nose high, and almost touching down at half throttle and then pulling the power. It's so draggy, and you do need to keep that nose up. And kind of the goal with that airplane is not to plop it down. You really need to set it so just the main wheels touch barely, and then that'll kind of pull the nose down. And again, that's because of the placement of the gear. If you watch the full scales land on an aircraft carrier in particular, I mean, you'll see how they slam their noses down. But even watching them land on a runway, watch the Blue Angels land, for example, the nose comes down. It's just the inherent nature of how the main gear work. And where they're positioned relative to the CG. And again, it is a draggy airplane, but man, I gotta say, it is one of our coolest EDFs by far. The thing looks so good. It sounds amazing in the air. Absolutely amazing. So,
it sounds really good.
Yep, I think it'll be okay as long as you watch out for those things.
Yep. A question I think we get every single time anybody from Horizon goes live. Let's see. Any hints on what's the next new release going to be? Is it an EDF? Does it have a propeller? What color is it? Anything that we can give is essentially what the question is.
I don't know if I should do this.
I mean,
if I do this, it's me.
Well, I mean, you're the boss, and you're not going to blame it on me.
The next release is an airplane.
Oh man, you done gave it away. It's
well, all right. I'll give you guys one more tip. I'm pretty sure the world is going to go into a frenzy or a flurry here if I do this. The main color on it is red.
That's fair. I'll take that.
But you know and what it is.
I hope
so. And it's not. Oh, okay, fine. So maybe to prevent the world from going crazy, I should say it's not all red.
Right. Are you going to say what the other color is?
No.
Oh, okay. All right. Fair enough.
But you said what is the next release? It's an airplane. You said what color? That's right.
Hey, well, hey, you know what? Hey, there. That's usually it's top secret. We got the little folder that says silence or you will take it out. But at least you guys got a little bit of tidbit there. Let's see.
So it's good. I love seeing these comments.
When will we see it? Who knows, guys? It's top secret.
Well, I mean, I know.
It's top secret, though.
Cody knows.
Right, here we go. Is it 200 miles per hour capable? No. maybe kilometers, man.
No, it's not kilometers. Not 200 kilometers. No.
All right. Let's see. Well, again, guys, if you have any of the questions, Jason and I are just going to hang out here for a few more minutes. We'll probably end it here at 5 because the real flight live is going to be happening here in a few minutes. So we'll be heading out here shortly. So if you have any last minute questions, go ahead and throw them in the chat now. And we will go ahead and hang out here for a few more minutes and answer them.
Yeah. I'll shout out to Bel Air Video. I see you post on RC groups as well, and we really appreciate it. We know you're a big supporter of ours down in Australia. And like he says here, I fly all my aircraft mostly scale and a lot in safe just for the enjoyment. And I will say that, guys, safe is not just for beginners and safe is not a crutch. There's a lot of tangible benefits to safe, even if you're an experienced pilot. And one of those is sometimes it just makes your experience super easy. You can literally sit in a chair and fly with one finger. I'm not saying you should.
I like to show people, like when I'm showing people, like what the controls are, I usually, am one hand half throttle and kind of just like, talking them through it as I'm flying. So, I mean, safe is used for multiple reasons, not necessarily just for a beginner. So cool, super cool software.
Ronald must have had a question here, which I think it looks like the group addressed. Yeah, I just got my MAL M7. When I set it to safe, it puts down elevator and a little right aileron. takes a lot of up elevator trim to level. So like the guy said, if it's sitting on its gear, it's got the tail down relative to level. And so Safe is going to see that nose up, and it's going to add some elevator, down elevator, to try and push the nose down, but you're not flying. So if you lift the tail up to level, you'll probably see it'll neutralize. Now, the aileron, that probably is a combination of factors. Either the receiver's not exactly level, but that's probably unlikely. But first and foremost, with any airplane, and not just airplanes equipped with ASRX and Safe, you must mechanically trim the surfaces. So before you fly your first flight, turn it to AS3X, turn Safe off, and make sure that your trims are centered and mechanically adjust your surfaces to center. A lot of guys don't do that. They take the airplane out of the box and the factories get them pretty close, but never perfect all the time. So make sure your ailerons aren't up a little bit or down a little bit, because if they are, now Safe, when you turn it on, at first it's going to go to level. Now, if you're mechanically off, it's going to have that aileron up, because Safe knows where level's at. So more than likely in the air, it's going to fly perfectly level, even if the ailerons are slightly off. On the ground, it's going to appear off, because I'm guessing 99% sure you're mechanically off.
It could also be another factor, guys. So as Jason mentioned, make sure the aircraft's perfectly level. Also, these receivers are secured using a layer of glue and sticky tape in most cases. So it is, being that we mass produce this stuff, it is absolutely possible that the receiver could be slightly off a degree or two left or right, meaning it's not perfectly level. So definitely look at the receiver as well. Make sure it's perfectly flat and level in the aircraft. Because if it's slightly off to the left or to the right, you're going to see that adverse reaction on the ailerons.
And so, do you see my dad's post in the chat there?
I didn't. What did he say?
Jive Turkey has been watching.
Oh, perfect. What was your word for him? What was the response word?
I don't even have one. All right, Dad. Well, thank you for watching. Shout out to my dad for watching.
Yes, Jason Merkle's dad.
That's the weirdest thing I've ever heard. That was literally before my time, Dad.
I love working with your son, and I hope you enjoyed the Citation Longitude video, the Cessna Longitude video. I hope you enjoyed that.
Yeah, hilarious. So real quick, in about a couple minutes here, a number of the guys are going to be live on Real Flight through our Horizon Hobby Facebook page. So if you guys want to see Steve Petrato, James Haley, Matt Andren, Juan Pablo Montoya flying on Real Flight, you can watch that live. You won't be able to join their session. It's a closed session to just those guys, but they're going to be talking about Real Flight and a couple other things. I did see a couple of questions and comments here about Real Flight. Number one, Real Flight for Mac. It probably isn't going to happen. And if it does happen, it definitely won't be anytime soon. It's very, very, very expensive to make it work on Mac. And so some guys do use it on Mac by running Bootcamp or Windows emulators. That's an option. And then someone did ask here about PS4 and Xbox. I would say that would probably happen before Mac would. Also, not anytime soon, but it is certainly on the list of potential things to have happen, because obviously in the world today, not everybody's going to own a laptop or a desktop computer. Not the way that it was, say, 10 years ago. So I think it's going to continue going that direction.
I want to kind of touch on it a little bit as well. I mean, of course, having it for the Xbox and PS4 would be hugely, beneficial to us as a company and for the user to introduce you to our products. But you're also not going to get that full experience of having it with, like, say, one of our Spectrum transmitters. So keep that in mind as well. The idea is we want to give you the realest experience possible. And that's kind of why the PC works best, because all of our components, our electronics, our transmitters will work in tandem with that. So we'd also want to, if we went to the console, we'd also want to kind of incorporate our transmitter for the console as well, just so you guys can get that full experience. So that way, if you do transition to go into actual purchasing one of our aircraft or another aircraft in real life and go to the field, you're going to get the best possible scenario, the best bang for your dollar, the best possible chance for success that you could. And I don't think you would get that with, say, like the Xbox controller or the PS4 controller. It's a completely different layout. The ergonomics are different. So I don't foresee that happening, but it is worth looking into.
So I think we're going to have to hop off here so those guys get on a Real Flight Live. But real quick, I saw Jordan, hopefully I pronounced this correctly, Duell. He said he's running RF8 on a Mac through boot camp. That's awesome. Guys, it can definitely be done. And again, we are going to be here next week, same time, same place. So be sure to tune in next week, bring your questions, bring your concerns. And again, we're going to hopefully do this weekly from here on out for as long as we can, especially now that a lot of us are currently at home, and it gives us a good opportunity to connect, even though we can't necessarily do it at an event. we could do it here online, which is the next best thing. So thank you guys for joining us. Appreciate it. And we'll be here next week. Look forward to seeing you then.
And for those of you who have some free time, we are going to end this live right now. You guys are seeing this on YouTube and Facebook. You're going to have Real Flight 9 with Juan Hablo. I can't say his last name very well, but Juan Hablo and Steve and everybody's going to be on there right after this show. So as soon as this ends, you guys will see that.
Yep. Check it out.
See you guys. Thank you.